Hi there. In this tutorial, which may become a multi-part tutorial depending on how quickly we go along, I'm going to show you how to create a scene like this. So in this scene, we've got the bottom of the trunk of a tree, we've got some grass in the scene, we've got a partially snow-covered ground, and obviously the main element of the scene is these snowdrops, and there's a little bit of depth of field in there as well. So let's just go straight into it and get started. So to begin with, we'll create a ground plane and just size that up a little bit. We'll look from above and we'll press W and select subdivide and put the subdivisions up. It will limit you to 10 by just sweeping the mouse, but if you click it, you can actually type in more. Let's go for 25 for the moment. I'm just looking from the side slightly, and I'm just going to select a few vertices randomly. There's many different ways of doing this. This is the way I'm doing it today. Press O for proportional editing, and then just pull the Z up a little bit, and you can play with the scroll wheel just to vary how much of the ground is affected. And now I'm going to select some more. This time some of them are on those already created humps and some of them are not. You can do this by using fractal when you subdivide, but doing it this way gives you a little bit more control. I think that's they're a little bit too high, so I'm just going to scale on the Z and just flatten them down a little bit and set it to smooth shading. I'm also going to press Control 1 to add a subdivision surface, and I'll probably be editing the shape of the ground a little bit more later on. So we'll just call that ground. Press the tab, A until everything's selected, U, and just project from view bounds. So that's now unwrapped, and we're going to put a texture on it. So just say new over here, diffuse texture, and we'll say image. If I can, I'll put a link to this texture in the description. It comes from ctextures.com. If you've got one that's similar, then that'll do the same sort of job. And the one I used is this one, which is called grass frozen 0033_2_L. So if we look at texture now, you can see that's the sort of texture it is. And we may want to rescale that and things in a minute. There's certainly more to do with the ground plane, so we're going to scale it up a little bit more, and G, Y just to push it back a little bit. I'm going to scale it a little bit more, and now I'm going to go to the camera and rotate on the x-axis that way, and G and zoom in a little bit, maybe raise it up a little, then rotate on the x again. I can pull it back a little bit now. So you can see that grass text is probably a little bit large. Various ways of rescaling that, but if we go to the UV image editor, select the ground, and then we can select the frozen grass texture. There you can see it's completely mapped to that texture now. And if I press S, I can now just scale that up and you can see the ground gets smaller. Now if this isn't a tileable texture, which this may not be, you have to be careful where you position this grid over here, this UV grid, against the image, because what you don't want is any lines appearing. So you can see there's a line across there, and that actually appears across the field of view of the camera. So if I move this, that should move that line, hopefully, out of the camera's view. There it is again. It'll be a lot less visible once we've got other kinds of grass and things like that on there. And obviously the larger you make it, the more of an issue that becomes. But we'll leave it as it is for now, and we'll worry about whether it's a problem later. Do make sure you save your blend regularly. And before we start rendering anything, I'm just going to come over here and set the dimensions to border. So that will just mean it doesn't render anything out here. I'm also going to set this to 50% just to make the renders quicker. So while we're in here, we may as well develop the texture for the ground. So going to the node editor, there's our image, there's the diffuse shader, and there's the material output. So to look at it properly, I'm going to need to just add a lamp into the scene. So Shift A, and I'm going to add a sun lamp. Position that over here, rotate it a little. Fairly low angle, I think, for this one. Could be morning or evening, probably morning. Not too much from the front, but about something like that. Set it to a slightly yellowy colour, and I'm going to try 2.5 for the brightness. So back through the camera view, and let's have a look at what that looks like rendered. So it's very dark at the moment. We're obviously getting some light from the sun. Possibly afford to make that a little brighter for the time being. And I'm also going to reduce the bounces. We really don't need that many. That should improve render time slightly. And the size of the sun I'm going to set to 0.025 for the moment, which means it's a fairly clear day. But you can see the ground is still not that well illuminated. Part of the reason for that is because the sky is currently black. If I look elsewhere, you can see everything else around here is black. So to fix that, I'm just going to come up to here, which is the world, click here and say sky texture. Now all of a sudden you can see the color balance on here has shifted, and if we look out here we can see that we've got a very basic sky texture. So that's starting to look a little better, but obviously it's just a photograph at the moment. So I'm now going to add a bump node and just drop that there. I'm going to take the image and drop that into height, and then I'm going to take the output of the normal and put that into the diffuse input on my shader, and immediately you can see that we've got a rather different texture there. So if I take it away and then put it back, I'm going to drop the strength slightly, somewhere around there, and you can play around with these values till you get something that looks about right for you. So the idea is we've got snow that's just perhaps melted and then refrozen. There's obviously some frost on some of this grass, but this isn't the primary grass we're going to see in the scene anyway. I'm not that keen on this little clump here anyway, but you can vary this strength to get what you think looks right for the scene, perhaps a little bit less. And then finally, because I think the colours are a little off, I'm going to add a hue saturation node. Drop that in there and then just increase the saturation a little bit, just to give us a little bit more life in the grass there. So that'll do for the texture on the ground for the time being. So now we'll make our tree. Just put the cursor about here somewhere. We'll look from above and press Shift A, and we'll add a mesh circle. Let's bring it up so we can see it. I'll look through the camera so we can get an idea for the proportional size. Doesn't matter that much because obviously we can resize it in a moment. Go into edit mode, press E and just extend it up with proportional editing off. Something like that. And then take the size down slightly, then extend it up again and perhaps take the size down a little bit more. Do need to make sure that it's tall enough, obviously depending on the scale of your scene, that any shadow it's casting extends appropriately. Now obviously that's a bit of a cylindrical tree at the moment. So what I'll now do is select 4 or 5 points around the edge here. And we'll start to extend those. I'll extend them a little bit. Now I'll turn proportional editing on. I'll extend them further. They look a bit strange at the moment, but that's okay. So that's beginnings of our roots. Alt right click that ring there that I left, and now start to bring it down. And you can see this is starting to work a little better. And now Control 2, and immediately we start to get something that looks a little better. And obviously you could play around with that. I can lower this bottom ring a little bit more. I can select this outer ring, I'll turn proportional editing off and extend it, and that just makes the roots extend a bit more, but ultimately they need to be just below the surface. So I think I'll shrink my tree a little bit, and I think I'll also lift my camera up. So I'm right clicking on the camera there, now press G, and I can afford, I think, to push the ground back a little bit, perhaps grow it a little bit. And now play with the angle of the camera slightly. So about there. You can spend a bit longer doing that. So that's basically our tree added. And one of the other things I did was I selected the ground. Once I placed my tree in edit mode, at least for the areas that are in the scene, and I'll do this over here as well because we might move the camera around a little bit. In fact, before I do that, I'm going to rotate this tree because I quite like the idea of having a sort of bowl there. Let's make it a little smaller. Need to make sure that the edge is all buried. And of course you can twist the roots slightly by just pushing them off to one side a little bit. And that just adds a little bit of extra detail and adds some variation to them. So that's a little bit more interesting. So what I now want to do is just select some of the vertices around the tree roots and just lift them up a little bit. And I think I'm going to subdivide it once more, just to give me a few more vertices. It's got a subdivision surface on it, of course. My thinking is that this sort of represents the root having gone beneath the ground, and it's just showing the root through the ground. And perhaps lift it up here a little bit as well, where dead leaves and what have you have accumulated. And you just play around with proportional editing. It doesn't matter too much, it's not a very visible detail. So we've obviously got a very white tree at the moment, so we need to put a texture on that. Before we can do that, we need to unwrap it. So I'm going to come around behind the tree and select a set of vertices like that, that are well out of sight of the camera. Control E and mark seam. Now select all the vertices. I'm going to bring up the UV image editor so that I can see how the unwrap goes. And first of all, we'll just try unwrap. And that's pretty good, actually. You can try unwrapping as a cylinder, but I don't think you'll get much better than that. And the reason it's done quite well is because we left the top and bottom ends open rather than closing them off. So now we need to select a texture. So I'm just going to say new. Need to call this tree. Need to get into the habit of doing that. So we'll just call this thing tree. Back to my textures and say image texture. And in my wood, this is the one I used, which is bark deciduous 0167_1_L. So I'm obviously using the larger versions of these images, primarily because this render is quite close up on these objects, so they need to be reasonably good quality images. So if you just go to texture mode, we can see what that looks like, and that's not too bad. Obviously you could play around with this a bit longer, but I think that's a pretty fair unwrap. So as we did with the ground, we now need to set that material up a little bit. So I'm going to add a few nodes. I'm going to add a gamma node. Now this one is really just for brightening and darkening the image that's being used, and I'm going to darken that a little bit. I found it was a little bit light for my purposes. I've just set that to 1.1, which means slightly darker. I'm going to add a color ramp node and put the image into one side of that. I'm going to set it to B-spline. Whether we use it or not remains to be seen. I'm going to add another bump node. Whether you use bump or just the displacement input is up to you. For most things, the difference is marginal. It does show up more on some of them. So that's under the vector node, as I showed you a moment ago. So connect the output of the bump into the normal input on the diffuse shader, and then take the color output and put that into the height on the bump. I'm going to set the strength to about 0.6, thereabouts. And then we need to add some more nodes. So I'm now going to add a mix shader, and I'm going to add a glossy shader, because most things have some degree of glossy. Put that into the other side of the mix shader. I prefer the Ashikmin Shirley method. Seems smoother. Make sure that's full bright. And I'm going to have a roughness of about 0.25. So this is what sort of blurs the reflection out. But it's going to be a very, very subtle reflection. So 0.007 is where I'm going to start with that. And then finally, just to add a little bit more detail to it, I'm going to add another color ramp node. Put the bottom marker up to about there somewhere, and connect that into displacement. And then I'm going to add a noise texture and plug that into there. It doesn't really matter whether you use factor or color. Set the scale to about 12, detail to about 4, and then we'll have a look what that looks like in the render, and I'll explain what all this does. So we have a close look at the tree. We'll start at this end. If I unplug this little displacement modifier, you may just be able to see that it's actually slightly smoother. And in fact, if I remove the color input and the bump input, now put my noise in, you can see that's just added a subtle variation on the surface. We may want to increase the subdivision surface to help with the shading here, but also make sure it's on smooth shading. I won't worry too much about that at the moment. So that's what the displacement is doing. If I take that away and now connect back the bump, which is based on the image itself, you can see that's showing the surface texture of the tree. So the combination of the two gives us a more interesting variation on the surface. And then finally, I take my tree image and put that into the diffuse, and that all works with those other two. So if I take that away again, I can vary what's being selected from the tree image here. So what bright parts at one level and what dark parts are another level can all be set with this little color ramp. And then the other side goes into my diffuse. So already we've now got our tree, and it's got a bit of a surface texture. So I'm going to cover, I think, just creating the grass and then add that in as a particle system, and then I'll save the remainder for the next tutorial. So we'll go to another layer. I'm going to add a light into this layer because we will be wanting to look at the texture we have on the grass. So we'll add a sun lamp, doesn't really matter where it is, similar sort of color to the other one, and something like brightness of 3. So I'm just going to add a plane, and I'm going to unwrap it there, even though I haven't finished forming this thing yet. I'm going to subdivide it, Control R, there. And now I'm going to take away these two vertices. I'm going to put a few subdivisions like that. And now I'm going to add a modifier, which is the mirror modifier. I'm going to select these vertices at the top. Or in fact, I'm going to select this vertex, press O for proportional editing, and just take that towards the middle. Turn on clipping. Should sort out any problems of it crossing over. So it doesn't look much like a grass blade at the moment, but if I now scale on the X and scale it up, perhaps not that much, scale on the X again, go to edit mode, select everything, move it up so that the little yellow dot there, or orange dot, is just above the bottom. We don't want it beyond the bottom. And scale on the Y again, just to make it a slightly taller blade of grass. And although I wouldn't recommend this if you're going to have an awful lot of blades of grass, I'm going to add Control 1, add a simple subdivision surface on it, and now I'm going to select that central point that central line and just proportional editing off, and just pull that central part down a little bit to give a little bit of shape to the grass blade. Select those end two, just make sure they're fairly close together. You don't need them completely on top of each other. And now what we will want to do is add a bit of shape to this blade of grass. So if we look at it side on, I've got the end vertices selected. With proportional editing on, I can start to drag this blade of grass down and rotate on the X. And make sure smooth shading's on. And I'll just rotate it up to an angle, something like that. Now you can use a raised things to create duplicates of the grass, but we want this to be fairly random, so I'm going to do it the manual way. So Shift-D to create a duplicate, rotate on the Z-axis without proportional editing on. And I think if we rotate 120 and divisions thereof are quite a good choice for leaves and flower petals and things like that. So 120, 60, 70 is another good one that works quite well. So Shift-D again, rotate Z minus 120. Each of them is identical there, so I'm going to scale that one down a little bit, scale that one up a little bit, and then obviously just move some of the vertices around just to make it a little different to the others. And obviously you can spend a lot more time doing this than I am here. So you see I'm in wireframe mode in order to be able to select through the leaf itself. It can get a bit confusing sometimes. I'm just randomizing really. And now I'm going to select each of the leaves, look from above, Shift-D, and we'll rotate 60 this time. And I'm going to scale on the Z-axis only, so it's SZ, and just take them up that way. And now perhaps alter the angle on these leaves a little bit, so we'll have that one going out a bit, that one going up. Generally, the smaller leaves will be on the inside, and again, looking to randomize the leaves a little bit. The subdivision surface forgives quite a lot of rough editing. So I'm going to apply the mirror modifier to each of those leaves now. I'll leave the subdivision surface where it is, select each of them, make sure they're all selected, and then select join. We've now got a grass plant. Each of the leaves have got their own unwrapping, so when we come to do the texture in a moment, that should work. So before I do any more, let's do that. So we'll go to the node editor again, go to material and say new, and we'll make sure that we name the grass, and in the material as well, because we may duplicate this texture, so we'll call the texture grass texture, and we'll go to rendered view. So we've just got a white grass blades at the moment, and we might want to put our subdivision surface up, but we certainly want to set it to smooth shading. So to begin with, I'm just going to add some nodes. Put this over here, and I'm going to add, under textures, a gradient texture. So let's just plug that, doesn't matter whether you use color or factor, into here. And by the way, when you're adding nodes, if you click this little pause button, that stops the preview render, which sometimes can be a bit of a pain when you're trying to add nodes. So you can see we've already got something going on the leaves. The tips of them seem to be darker. I'm going to add texture coordinate. We unwrap these leaves, so we'll say UV, and you can see we've now got the gradient in the middle. If you didn't unwrap it, you can also use some of the others, like generated, but it depends what you're trying to do. So I'm going to add color ramp, and I'm going to put that in there. We'll set it to B spline, which is the more gentle curve, and at the bottom here, I'm going to set that to a sort of greeny yellow color, fairly light. At the top, similar sort of color. And now I'm going to add three more nodes, three more points. Put one here, and that's going to be quite a strong green color. Maybe a little more blue and a little darker than that. I think we'll do without that one, but we'll use this one here. And again, we'll have quite a strong green color, but perhaps a little darker. So at the moment, and you might want that, you can see the gradient is going the wrong way. So one quick way of adjusting that in the UV image editor, I've gone to edit mode and selected all the vertices. And I'm just going to say R90. Now you can see it's turned around. It's still actually the wrong way around for what I want. I could just change it up here, but the easiest thing to do is say R180. And now you can see that my gradient is from the bottom of the blade of grass upward. And I can adjust where the colors show by tweaking this. So I need to make sure that this is within that square, because that's where the gradient's occurring. And now you can see I've got something going on at the tips and at the bottom. And you might use this particularly if you're going to show the grass as sort of drying out at the top. I just really wanted some level of variation. So you can see there, now that I've got it the right way around, this adjusts the amount of lighter color we have at the bottom here. I'm going to make it a little more yellow. And this one adjusts the top. I think I'm going to swap these two over. So that's a very basic texture. I'm just going to zoom in on a leaf now. And we need to add a bit more. So I'm going to add a noise texture. Make sure we connect the same UV coordinates in. Theoretically, you don't need to connect these if they're UV and you've unwrapped, but some nodes seem to need it. Move that gradient texture back, and I'm going to add a math node and plug that there and set this to multiply. I'm going to add color mix node and drop that in there. Set this to a factor of 1 and set it to multiply. So no, you can see there's no change yet. I'm then going to take the noise from here and put that into here. And we'll start to get a change. I'm going to set the scale a little higher. And what you may just be able to make out is we're starting to get some sort of striations on the leaf now. And obviously that's to simulate what you get on real grass blades. And you just need to set the scale. I've set it to about 8.5 there. I'm now going to add another color ramp. I'm going to take the output from my noise texture into that color ramp. Set it to B-spline. I'm going to add a math node. Set to multiply and take the output of that color ramp into that. Set this down to something like 0.2 or 0.1. We'll go for 0.2 for the moment. And then the output of that multiply node goes into displacement. And that's really just to give a little bit more sort of hint of ridges on the surface. There you go. I've increased that quite a bit now. Don't go too mad on that. But nevertheless, there we go. That's added a little bit more. So one last thing we need to do is to add some shininess and some translucence to our blades of grass. This is our color, so I'm going to add a gamma node and take one side of the color into that. I'm now going to add translucent node. And the other side of my gamma node goes into that. And I set my gamma to about 1.3. Now add an add shader, put that on the other side of the diffuse. The unused side of the add shader we put our translucent into, and you can see the leaves lightened up a bit. So the reason we've got about 1.3 on the gamma node is just to simulate that some of the light's being absorbed when it passes through. Now we'll add another shader, which is a mix shader, and another shader, which is a glossy shader. Set that to the Shirley method, set it to full bright, and mix that in. So you see it's very bright at the moment. I found about 0.1 was around the right level. You might want to vary it a bit more, but the mix needs to be down at about 0.01. So you get a bit of shine on the leaves, but not too much. Now, these leaves have no thickness. You could add a solidify modifier, or just model the thickness, but of course that's adding an awful lot of vertices. And grass blades are so thin that unless it's a real close-up, you don't really need to do that. So that's our basic texture. We've probably got a bit too much of the brighter root showing there, so I'm going to just take that down a little bit. And what you then need to do is to create variants of this grass plant. So I'm going to create two more. I'm going to rotate them a little bit to start with, and then with proportional editing on, move some of the vertices around. Obviously, you spend a lot more time. I'm just showing you the principles. You don't need to see me create every element, I'm sure. And just create some variation. Control L, by the way, will select a whole leaf once you've selected some of the vertices. I've made that leaf a little smaller. I'm just adding some variation into them. And you need to do a bit more than that, obviously. So once you've got some plants, I suggest a minimum of 3. Really, you need 5 or 6 variants so that they really do look quite different each. Once you've got them all selected, Control G, and you see they'll all turn green. And over on the left-hand side, you'll get a group, and we'll call this grass group. And we'll come back to our land. So if we look through the camera, obviously this whole area is covered in grass, but there's no point in having grass particles where you can't see them. So I'm just going to press C. I'm going to go into wireframe mode and press Z to go into wireframe mode so that we can select vertices that we can't actually see. Press C just for area select, and then make sure you select an area that's just outside the camera. Don't stop at the edge of the camera, otherwise it'll look a little odd. And select the ground that is going to be visible to the camera. You can always vary this later if you do decide to move the camera, but it saves a lot of rendering time and things like that not to have to render particles that aren't actually showing up. We'll just have a look from the top. And you can see we've missed a few little bits there because of the raised areas of the ground. So I'll just smooth that out so we get a reasonable amount of ground. And you can see this is the area that the camera can see. So go to Object Data, click the plus under Vertex Groups, and we'll call that Grass. Just double click it and then select Assign. Press A to unselect everything and click select just to check that it worked, which it did. And then we can go to our particles. We'll say we've got the ground selected and we'll say new. We'll call this particle system grass. You have to do it twice. And we'll set it as a hair particle system. We can unclick Cycles Hair Rendering because we're not actually going to render hair particles. And we go to Group under the Render and select our grass group. Click Rotation and pick Random. And as always happens, it will fall over like that on its side. So go to the layer where your grass is, select the grass, rotate Y 90. Come back and there they all are, doing a better job anyway of standing up. But they're a bit uniform at the moment, obviously. So before we do anything else, let's reduce the size of them. So that's hair length. Let's try one, a little bit small, so we'll come up from there. I'm going to click Advanced, Use Modifier Stack, which uses the extra vertices provided by the subdivision surface. Unclick Even and select Random. I think that's a better approach. Click that little checkbox to adjust rotation and we'll set it to Global Z, because plants normally grow up. But then we'll add a little bit of variation on it. Not too much, because you'll have some plants lying down otherwise. And most importantly, put full random on phase, which basically means they should rotate randomly every time that a new particle is created. We now need some randomness on the size. Don't go all the way to one, or you'll have some really, really tiny grass plants, which wouldn't seem quite right. And now we can come down to vertex groups. Under density, we can select the grass vertex group. And now you can see we've only got grass in this area. So we'll have a look at what that's looking like. And that's not too bad. I'm going to set the samples for the preview down to 10. And for the full render, we'll set to 25. I'm also going to, under light pass, turn off reflective and refractive, which are there more for liquids and glasses. You don't really need them for these sorts of scenes. I'm going to put a little bit of a filter on the glossy. And we'll say clamp indirect at 6, which just helps to reduce any fireflies when you've got low samples. So the scene's starting to come together. We may need to adjust the color balance for the grass slightly, but it's starting to work. So we can come over to children. It's up to you whether you use them. Depends how dense you want this grass. We've currently got 1,000 grass particles. Depending on how much grass you want coming through, that may not be enough. So if we go to children and we say interpolated, you can see that's created a lot. I haven't allowed it to re-render the center yet, but let's just say display and render 10. So if we now allow that to render, you can see that's an awful lot of grass blades. That's 10,000 grass blades, it's way too much. So it's up to you whether you use children or not, or whether you just control the number of particles directly. So we could put, say, 3,000 particles. So I've turned the children off now. You can see that's rendering quite a bit faster. And I think that's enough, really. We don't really necessarily need a much denser grass plant than that for this particular scene, though perhaps they need to be slightly smaller. So we can come down to size and perhaps set that to 0.03. And now we can perhaps increase the density a little bit to 5,000. And you can play around with that. But one other thing we can do with the particles, at the moment they're fairly homogeneous in their density, is that we can use a texture to vary how dense these particles are. We could even use the image texture, but rather than that, what I'm going to do, under textures, we'll just say new, and then we click this little control here, and that takes us over to here. By default, it goes to image or movie. Change that to clouds, make the size quite a bit bigger, something like 1. Under colors, increase the contrast. Once you've done that, unclick time and click density. Now you can see we've got patches appearing that don't have particles. So we can adjust the size again. Perhaps if we come down a little bit smaller, 0.75, maybe even 0.5, we'll go for 0.65. And we can play around with the contrast, whether we want more or less blades of grass. Back to 0.75, I think. So you can now see that we've got, you should just be able to make out that there are areas where there are no grass particles appearing. So maybe we can increase the grass particles slightly now. We'll go for 7,500 and we'll see what that looks like. And already you can see it's taking shape. So I'll just give that a slightly better render and then we'll call it a day. And you can see that took less than 10 seconds to render that with 7,500 particles, and that's not bad at all. So you can see now, because of the patchiness, although I haven't aligned the patches of grass to where the snow has melted already, which you could do, it's starting to work. Possibly the grass is a little bit too green, but then again, new grass is very green. See what I meant about the shadow of the tree? You need to make sure that the tree object is tall enough that the shadow doesn't stop somewhere like this. Having the blue sky gives you this blue light here. At the end of this, we'll actually put a little bit of compositing on there just to enhance that blue look, to give you that sort of cold early spring, late winter look. But I think for where we are, that's quite a good place to stop. So thanks for watching this tutorial. If you enjoy them, don't forget to subscribe, especially if you want to see part two of this tutorial. And I'll see you in the next one. Thanks a lot.